Welcome, Ramachandra Guha. I'm not going to introduce you. It's a waste of time. You have a similar background to a lot of people in position and power in industry, which is the Doon School and Stevens. But you're very different from all of them. What went right?
I think I'm not alone, Madhu. I mean, there's some extraordinary people the Doon School produced. I mean, the Doon School produced Amitav Ghosh, Vivan Sundaram, the pioneer of social work in India, Sanjeev Bankar Roy,
yes,
a pioneer of Indian environmentalism, Dunu Roy. The St. Stephen's has produced some outstanding social workers. Pratham, which is a great educational NGO, which produces the annual survey of education reports, is run by a woman called Rukmini Banerjee.
She used to be who you've dedicated the book to.
So I think St. Stephen's especially, and even the Doon School has had its rebels and dissenters.
Okay,
and
so they're redeemed.
What I'm saying is I'm part of an honourable tradition.
All right.
To which I belong, in both cases.
Yeah. Now, going straight into your book, one of the chapters that I want to deal with right away is the Hindutva hate mail. Do you think this extreme polarizing on Facebook, on Twitter, do you think that, one, is it a dangerous sign? Two, is it because, as most people say, because of the appeasement policies that the government has been following?
Well, certainly the Congress government has been guilty of shocking double standards, of not honoring the values and principles of the constitution. The Shah Banu case is a great example. But the left front government, for example, and its refusal to allow Taslima Nasreen to live a dignified life in West Bengal. So there's been a great pandering to Muslim extremists.
Rashti being told don't
come
to
the
Jep.
Yeah, but at the same time, there's been great pandering. Hindu extremists, Hussein is not allowed in. Everywhere the BJP is in power, they doctor the textbooks. I mean, it's true in my home state of Karnataka, it was true in Murli Manohar Joshi and the kind of work he did.
Yeah.
So this is not excuse it, but it's to say that I don't understand the anger. How can Hindus who are 85% in this country feel besieged? It's true that the Congress has cultivated the most reactionary elements among the Muslim leadership. But it's also true that Muslims are totally underrepresented in the professions, in your profession, the media, in my profession, scholarship. There's isolated Muslim professors, Supreme Court lawyers, doctors. So Muslims are doing badly economically in this country. It may be because of their reactionary leadership, that's possible. It may be for a variety of reasons, their legacy of Pakistan. But when Hindus are doing, the majority they're doing, but how can they feel? And the venom and the anger with which these mails are expressed. So you say you receive some of this too, Madhu, because, when I wrote this, a journalist friend of mine saw the excerpt and she said, that's a great piece, but, women get it even worse.
Mm-hmm.
That the mail is abusive, but the mail to some of the women journalists or women intellectuals, I'm told Romila Thapar gets the most abusive mail because she's a scholar and a woman.
Right.
How much suppressed anger and animosity, Madhu, to someone you've never seen, who's a virtual figure, And I, as I said, it's in the essay, I always answer back.
But isn't it becoming a decade of rage, whether it's road rage or anti-corruption rage or frustration rage?
There's a difference. I mean, you're right about the rage. What's happened is the aspirations of young people have increased. So our economic growth is not able to sustain it. The rage, you're absolutely right. There's male rage. Raj Thackeray's movement is male rage. The Naxalite movement is young male rage. Car Sevaks is male rage. But these are actually successful software professionals. So it makes it even stranger. I mean, who have access to the internet, who have access to reading all the different journals and then expressing the rage in a kind of, it's a more strange and even impotent rage. So what is remarkable is the lack of proportion and the complete absence of a sense of humor. There's a line here where I say a certain kind of Hindu prays to the sun god, drinks a glass of cow's milk and serves the net for secular heresies. And I'm told that Twitter is, ablaze. I'm not on social media, but I'm told Twitter is ablaze with attacks on me. How dare you say cow's milk? It's an ironical, humorous remark. Surely Hindus have to be tolerant and be willing to make a couple of jokes at their own expense.
So I think the answer to that is in this passage in where you've written. If you could read from this rests.
The sociological background of the Hindutva hate mailer can be constructed from his name and background. His ideology is directly manifested in his mails. This rests on a deep suspicion of and hostility towards Indians who are not Hindus by religious background. And yet, as the historian Dharma Kumar once pointed out, the philosophy of Hindutva only mimics and reproduces the ideology of its major adversary. Its unacknowledged model is the Islamic State, where those who do not belong to the ruling faith are tolerated if they are obedient and subservient, but attacked if they seek to assert the rights of equal citizenship. I'm glad you asked me to read out this passage, Madhu, because, you know, we should not make India into a Hindu Pakistan.
So, does that make anyone a less Hindu if you do not want to scream against Muslims?
Absolutely, Madhu, absolutely. It's interpretive and it's plural. And in a sense, the answer or the counterpart to the essay on Hindutva hate mail in this book is the essay on Gandhi's religious faith. You know, because Gandhi was Hindu. I mean, he called himself a Hindu, he died with the name of Ram on his lips. But he, his Hinduism was accommodative, plural, flexible. He wanted a dialogue with other faiths. And he also recognized the flaws in his own religion. He knew that Hindus treated women and untouchables abominably, and that had to be changed. So it was also self-corrective, self-reflective, continuously evolving religious tradition. That was
and
Gandhi.
He invented his own.
It was not frozen. I mean, Islam is frozen in the 7th century. Now, our Hindutva people want to freeze us in the Vedic age, which is even older than the 7th century.
You've also written really a fun chapter on Chamchagiri.
Congress Chamchagiri.
You've also mentioned that, for I'm a long-standing critic of the Congress Party's first family, and have, as a later essay in this book, In Nehru's House, A Story of Scholarship and Psychofancy explains, suffered professionally because of this. What has happened?
No, in the sense that the campaign I was part of, and in a sense leading to, was delayed and derailed for several years because I was painted, I quote...
The campaign to restore the Nehru Memorial Library to what it was.
There's a passage I quote in that essay where, from India After Gandhi, where I show Rajiv Gandhi's behavior after the butchery of the Sikhs was similar to that of Narendra Modi after the butchery of the Sikhs. And that was used against me to discredit the campaign.
Yeah.
Fortunately, in the end, reason prevailed and the persistent, dogged work of scholars to revive and restore the Nehru Museum seems to have succeeded. And, you know, hopefully Congress sometimes won't, you know, interfere with that place again.
You've talked about Anna Hazare's judgment of whom to trust was also called into question. One close advisor was found not to have honored a financial agreement made voluntarily to his employer, that is the government.
Yeah.
That is Arvind Kejriwal.
Yeah.
Another having regularly fudged her travel bills, Kiran Bedi. The amounts unpaid or pilfered were trifle compared to those stolen by government ministers. Still the fact, but isn't there this, again, the issue of reprisals? That when somebody is questioning the government, their income tax department, enforcement directorate, starts going through a fine-tooth comb, with a fine-tooth comb.
Absolutely.
There's always, you can always find...
With the Helka, which you've written about. Absolutely, you know, absolutely.
They'll find something.
But that's why you must be squeaky clean. When Anna Hazare stands for probity in personal life, it's true of him, or public life.
But how squeaky clean can you be in a country like this? Right?
You can't first travel bills. You cannot first travel bills. I mean, that to me is...
And she was giving it to her...
That's what she claimed later. But you cannot first travel bills. I mean, I come from a family of public servants. I was not allowed to sit in my father's staff car. My father only called his staff car when he had to go to be dropped to the station. Otherwise, he cycled to work. He was the head of a scientific research laboratory. I was not allowed to sit in it. So, you know, I know what it means.
So you mentioned Manmohan Singh denying somebody a ride.
Back to saying,
do you mind if your car drops me after he drops you? And he said, you mind if he didn't?
That's it, yeah, absolutely.
So personally, the man is okay.
Yeah, but he...
But...
He condones all of that, sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
And you've gone through...
I've gone in detail, I've talked about all
exactly.
the...
Exactly, you've given
the tragedy
four...
of Manmohan Singh. Yeah.
And you've given his timidity, not contesting a Lok Sabha election, lack of judgment in choosing key advisors, particularly related to the media, keenness to win good chits. And the most
the
obnoxious
family.
Thing when he told George Bush, the people of India love you.
And deference to the fourth, first family, which is the last one, yeah.
Very frightening.
Yeah. You know, there's a line of Yeats which says, the best lack all intensity and the worst are full of passionate conviction. I mean, Manmohan Singh is the best, but he lacks, you know, moral courage.
Yeah.
It's really the fundamentalists and the bigots, you know, the Naxalites, the Hindutvavadis, the jihadis who have the who stand for what they do, who have courage, and the most horrible views. And here is a man who has the right ideals, the right values, the right technical and professional background, and yet is so spineless.
I wonder how a psychologist would analyze that the people who are more on the liberal side are more tolerant, are also not loud enough to get their voices heard.
That's true. And I think one of the things I try to do in this book is to be polemical, to be vigorous, and because liberals can't really be, you know, pussy-footed or excessively polite anymore, because otherwise they'll lose the space that they occupy will be, you know, taken over by the extremists.
I'd ask you to read this where you've done a what-if. Which I think is wonderful.
Had Shastri continued as Prime Minister until the end of the 1960s, the economic history of India would have turned out very differently. In the 1950s, under the direction of the state, India had nurtured a robust domestic industry. It was now time to allow for the free play of market forces. In speeches made in 1965, Shastri clearly indicated that he would like to open up the market to enterprise and free competition. Sadly, he died soon afterwards. Instead of trusting to the energy of the private sector, Indira Gandhi strengthened the control of the state over the economy. Had fate given Shastri a longer innings as Prime Minister, then the Indian economy would have been more robust and resilient. But he was also a pragmatic reformer. He would have freed the processes of production from state control and also initiated welfare measures to ameliorate poverty. As a man of vision and integrity, he would have also sought to improve the performance of India's public institutions. Had Shastri lived another 5 or 10 years...
This is the best part.
Had Shastri lived another 5 or 10 years, it is highly unlikely that Indira Gandhi would ever have become Prime Minister. And it is certain that her son would never have occupied that office. Had Shastri been given another 5 years on earth, there would have been no Nehru-Gandhi dynasty. Had Shastri lived another 5 years, Sanjay Gandhi and Rajiv Gandhi would almost certainly still be alive. Sanjay Gandhi would be a failed entrepreneur, and Rajiv Gandhi, a recently retired airline pilot with a passion for photography. Finally, had Shastri lived another 5 years, Sonia Gandhi would still be a devoted and loving housewife, and Rahul Gandhi, a middle-level manager in a private sector company. And in my view, they would have been happier and India would have been happier. They would have not lost, you know, so many members of their family to accident and tragedy. They would have been happier leading a quiet, dignified existence, and India would have been a more contented and better run place.
Can we take this what if a little further? What Indira Gandhi did with the Kamraj plan. They put her in power, as we all know, as the Gungi Gudiya.
Yeah.
And then she turned it around. What if Manmohan Singh was put there as this obedient Prime Minister who did exactly what she did in the Kamraj plan? He became a real Prime Minister.
Absolutely, he could have.
Was not grateful to her for being, as you said, she needs him more. Sonia Gandhi needs him.
As much as
he does. But does he really? Could he have done what
could have.
Indira Gandhi
could have.
Did?
I think the turning point, was beyond the scope of this book, but now that you ask the question, Madhu, the turning point could have been when Arjun Singh attacked the National Knowledge Commission. You know, Manmohan Singh, one of his first initiatives was to set up a National Knowledge Commission. And it had some outstanding people. It had Nandan Nilekani, Professor Andre Bete, Pratap Bhanu Mehta, Sam Pichoda, some very good scientists on it. It was very good to think of ways of making our universities and research laboratories more contemporary, more cutting edge, more in tune with a complex globalized world. It was a good initiative. Arjun Singh saw it as a threat to the education ministry. He went to the press and said, "Ye bakwas hai, who they are not elected, who are they? Kaise kar sakte hain?" Now, instead of checking them, he said nothing to his minister. Andre Bete resigned out of disgust and the whole system collapsed. So he should have told Mrs. Gandhi, "This is important for the future of the country. In fact, it has to nurture the kind of institutions that will take our economic growth forward." In fact, what he did was to undermine his own reforms which he had started, but he lacked the courage. And Mrs. Gandhi would have said, "Look, okay, maybe you want a new education minister? We will make Arjun Singh governor of Uttar Pradesh." You know, there were ways in which to do it in a dignified, without Arjun Singh feeling hurt. Usko vice president bana denge, you get a good young person as education minister, forward-looking person. But that first hesitancy cost him so much that, you know, he could never assert himself. We had asserted himself then. Come to 2009, if he had said, "I will this time fight for the Lok Sabha," you know, Madhu, the Akalis would have let him win from Punjab. The Akalis would have allowed a Sikh Prime Minister to lose.
Yeah.
If people with no political backing like I.K. Gujral and Narasimha Rao can win, could have won Lok Sabha seats. So I think, Manmohan Singh had insisted and got good ministers of his choice, I think you could have had a different government, a government that is not so totally discredited.
And that isn't even such a contentious issue.
It would have been widely welcomed by a large cross-section of society. Because Arjun Singh is the old-style Congress politician patronage. "Ye hamara chamcha, isko yahan vice chancellor bana do, usko wahan bhej do," you know, that kind of stuff.
Do you think that this timidity of this Prime Minister has been the undoing of everything? Is there no place for a person who's gentle, who...
No, you can't just... You see, Shastri was gentle. Shastri was soft-spoken. I mean, there's a wonderful story about Shastri, which I tell in India After Gandhi, but which is relevant to what your comment and your question. Nehru dies in May 1964. In October, Shastri is going to the Commonwealth Prime Minister's Conference in London. He stops in Karachi to refuel. Karachi is then the capital of Pakistan. Ayub Khan, who is president of Pakistan, comes to meet him. And he sees a tiny man in a dhoti, kurta, chota sa baya. He says, he is Nehru's successor. He's pure. Can he hold India together? And after seeing Shastri, 6 months later, Ayub Khan sends infiltrators into Kashmir and starts the 1965 war. And Shastri's immediate reaction is, you send infiltrators into Kashmir, I will make a charge for Lahore. He opens a new front in Punjab and the whole history of the war changes. So you can be quiet, you can be soft-spoken, but you can be firm and decisive. So Shastri is a good example of a good man, but also a courageous man who a person
designing a real accident.
Absolutely,
I mean, all that. Set really good precedents.
So yeah, various theories. One theory, you talk about psychologists. I'm not a psychologist, so I don't go in for psychological speculation. But a friend of mine who understands these things better than I do said that Manmohan Singh was so profoundly grateful that Madam ne mujhe is kursi pe bitha diya hai. I would never ever thought I would be Prime Minister. That I was so deeply grateful that jo woh kahegi main karunga. I'll never question her. His diffidence in front of her, because as I said, and I'm glad you agree, that she knew she needed him. She couldn't run the government. She had no administrative competence, no academic background, and she knew that to run this government you needed a competent man like Manmohan Singh. And if it insisted, for these ministries I want these people. I won't take these old style Congress patrons. I'd want some fresh blood. He would have got his way.
Are people like Rahul Gandhi completely, absolutely irrelevant?
No, I think now, because of economic growth, in 25 years of economic growth, there's a large growing cosmopolitan middle class who wants again to break away from confining identities of caste or language or religion, but not from the top down, from the bottom up. And they want a cosmopolitan forward-looking leader. So there is place for a person like Rahul Gandhi, except that Rahul Gandhi clearly seems to lack the vision. And also the physical courage. I mean, he doesn't have the fire in his belly to conduct a campaign, to go to UP. If he wanted to win the UP state elections, he should have shifted camp to Lucknow, lived there 18 months, and said, "Main aapke liye yahan kaam karne aaya hoon," and not go for one day, parachute back to Delhi. So Rahul Gandhi is clearly unfit to lead even the Congress party. I mean, that's clear. I mean, that's just a mismatch. I mean, he should not be there.
And one of the things you mentioned was that in abolishing the British Raj, Crocker wrote, and in propagating ideas of equality, Nehru and the upper class Indian nationalists of English education abolished themselves. Yeah. Nehru destroyed the Nehrus. Yeah. Now, can we apply that now?
In terms of politics, you're right. Politics has to be grounded. Mamata Banerjee, I saw her on television, gave a 1 hour interview in English, which is not her language. And she held herself perfectly. She can give a 5 hour interview in Bangla. You ask her to speak Hindi also, she speaks. Politics is about communication. As Akhilesh Yadav, as you said, communicating. Rahul Gandhi has never given an interview to anyone, even in English. Forget English, Hindi, right? So politics is about communication, about immersing yourself, and I think that's something he seems incapable of. I think another reason I think he's unlikely to succeed is that the charisma of the family is declining. I mean, what the aura of Indira Gandhi was passed on to some extent to Rajiv Gandhi. And Rajiv Gandhi, to his credit, though he made many mistakes, had a vision. We will make India a technology superpower. At least something that was attractive and positive and forward-looking. Isme to kuch nahi hai. And you can't say, mere daddy ne ye kara tha, mere dadi ne ye kara tha. That's all he says. He says, daddy would have not allowed the Babri Masjid to be demolished. When he goes, as you correctly point out, it's a point of pettiness. He'll go, he'll take Sam Pitroda. I don't know whether you remember this. In the UP elections, he wanted to cultivate the backward caste vote. So he took Sam Pitroda, who said, "My daddy brought him and brought him up, and I will bring the rest of you up." I mean, how out of touch can you be? And in any case, Sam Pitroda came up because of his own enterprise, not because daddy recognized him after he had become a successful entrepreneur. So how patronizing can you get?
Also, if this government, people in power, don't seem to feel the need to communicate to the people, even when the Congress party has been exposed a lot of corruption, Robert Vadra's Herald House, Rahul Gandhi and Sonia Gandhi's corruption. The Congress rally that took place afterwards, they did not respond to the people about these charges. They spoke about the BJP's corruption. The BJP was pointing fingers at the Congress. So the two parties, the major political parties, are talking to each other and still not talking to the people. After all, the people need to hear an answer from the politicians who have been accused of this corruption.
Absolutely.
But they do not feel the need to address it.
Absolutely. Extraordinary arrogance. And I think that's why people like Anna Hazare and now Arvind Kejriwal have touched the court. Because, you know, because of this insolence and arrogance and standoffish behavior of the two major political parties.
And you've written articles about Anna also. And that has kind of, as you almost predicted in your articles, that it has only touched the anger that's already existing, but it's not taking it forward. Now, since you wrote that article, Arvind Kejriwal is forming a political party. What do you think of that direction?
Well, I think it's... any new party is welcome. Any new initiative is welcome. My worry about this initiative now is that it's become too negative. You know, my view is that the media is extremely good at flagging and highlighting a problem. But it's not good at resolving a problem. My view retrospectively would be that when Anna Hazare went on fast in Delhi and brought the government down to his knees and forced them, they were so arrogant to begin with, but then forced them to have a committee where five ministers met with five civil society activists. At that stage, they should have had the restraint and the sagacity, Team Anna, to say, keep the media aside, no television cameras. For the next 3 weeks, we're going to push these ministers and with experts like Shanti Bhushan and others, come up with a really good Lokpal bill and get it passed through parliament. So the media is good at highlighting a problem and giving visibility to
but not a blow-by-blow account as they come out of each meeting.
Arey, kya bola? Sibal ne kya bola? Arey, wo to bol. Sibal is happy to call. In fact, you know, I actually know Kejriwal a bit. So when this is going on, you know, Sibal and Salman Khurshid made some casual offhand remarks. So I called Kejriwal from Bangalore. I said, don't answer them. If, you know, Times Now puts a mic in front of you and says, Sibal bolte hai, toh aap toh aise hai, bilkul dheele hai, kuch nahi aap mein. Don't answer. Don't be provoked. Get a good bill passed. And I think that's what happens. Then, you know, and I think again
you
now...
You've written a chapter on compromise.
Yeah,
which
that's
which is
it.
Really an important chapter.
Absolutely.
In terms of Kashmir, Naxals, and you talked about the Tamils in Sri Lanka
and
compromise. And now you can apply it to this.
And that was Gandhi's method. You start a salt satyagraha, then you... you bring the government to negotiating table and then you try to get, you know, devolution of power to Indians, you know.
But this seemed to be like eating the menu. I mean, they just did the superficial stuff, put on the Gandhi cap, did the fasting, but never got to the real crux of it.
I think when Anna Hazare was there, there was this groundswell of public anger that he tapped into. And I think they could have got a compromise. They could have got a real law passed, you know, if they pressed rather than go back and have more fasts and more dharnas and more TV studio work and more abuse. No, I think they shouldn't have succumbed to that.
You also have written about Gandhi's influence, being influenced by Christianity and Buddhism. And isn't now this what has happened with the Hindutva influence? Isn't it becoming, we're talking about just the religion of the majority of people in India. Isn't it now the most confused state, or is this part of Hinduism that confusion is all right? Or we don't look at it as confusion, we say each man sab hero bane hoenge.
I think confusion is good. I think Hinduism traditionally was a decentralized, diverse religion. I think the Sangh Parivar tried to homogenize, centralize it. So, just as the Roman Catholics have their Rome, we will have our Ayodhya. Just as they have one God, we will have our one God. I think that attempt has failed. That attempt was very destructive. It caused a lot of conflict and anguish and suffering among ordinary Hindus and ordinary Muslims. But the attempt has failed, and now we've gone back to each one his own god man. You know, someone is Jaggi Vasudev, someone is somebody else. You know, so that's fine. I mean, Hinduism is not a centralized faith. I mean, it's not a dogmatic faith,
thank
it's
god.
A single text. Thank God. But they tried to make it that. The Sangh Parivar tried to make it that, and to model it a kind of Islamic, Islamic or Christian model of what faith is all about.
Where Hindus are not an obedient people. We're not used to Ten Commandments and fatwas.
Yeah.
We're used to any Shastra or Veda or Upanishads we want to pick up.
Flip side of that is Hindus also don't build institutions.
Yeah.
Because they can't work collectively together. So, you know, the beauty of Hinduism, which is its anarchy, is also antithetical to the building of good institutions that a modern society needs. So, in some ways, Hindus need to become more Christians, not more Muslims.
Or maybe
Muslims.
More scholarship.
Yeah, but
with angry internet Hindus. Maybe those issues have to be addressed by scholars. I think there's a feeling of being lost also.
Absolutely. I think it's a duty of scholars to address this. Too many of our scholars are in their ivory tower writing for each other. You know, I think...
As journalists are.
As journalists
writing for each other.
Yeah, I think journalists need to write books. it's been my long-standing view that you've written a book. More people like you need to write books, you know, because you're on ground field report. And this 1,000-word report is confining. And if you followed a beat for 8-10 years, you can convert it into a book. You know, and some journalists are doing this. There's a great book by a young journalist called Harish Damodaran, who's a business journalist, on the new capitalist class. How it's no longer, you know, just the Baniyas or the Parsis, it is, you know, the Reddys and the Gaunders and the Marathas. And so more journalists need to write books. More scholars need to write accessibly for mainstream media, not just in academic journals led by three professors in JNU. So I think that's something that it has to be. And there is a hunger for knowledge. I think there are many young people who want to know more about our recent history, want more detached, reflective analysis, but they must be presented in an attractive way, not in a turgid, boring academic prose. I think that's where our scholars have failed, the reading public.
One thing I wanted to ask you, your chapter on China seemed to be almost a red herring in this book.
Okay.
Why did you choose to write about China? I mean, it's very interesting. And one question I want to ask you is, why did Atal Bihari Vajpayee sign a document? I mean, this to me was an eye-opener. Yeah. Why did he sign a document accepting Tibet as part of China?
No, Atal Bihari, I think, he was a curious person. I think he may have been just, I mean, it's entirely possible he was absent-minded, he didn't read it.
But I think it's more a lovely story. Yeah,
but
I don't know what I'm signing.
But it's more likely that, you know, he's the first, immediately after becoming foreign minister, he goes to Pakistan. So he wanted to reach out. I mean, in that sense, he was something of Nehru and Atal Bihari Vajpayee, to go the extra mile to build trust with an enemy. So I think that's all right. I think I put that China piece because it's an aspect of Nehru that is which is interesting and relevant. You know, it gives the flavor of the debates. It was the 50th anniversary. It's now the 50th anniversary of the China war. So
a lot has been written about it. Yeah. But now it also sort of makes you a little nervous about Arunachal with China's...
I don't think anything will happen. My view is the Chinese want to win only economic battles, not military battles. You know, they'll make noises and they will say, you can't allow the Dalai Lama to go. But that's their way of, putting pressure on you and making you nervous. I mean, I'm glad that one of the good things that our Prime Minister did was when the Dalai Lama was going to Tawang, the great Buddhist monastery in Tawang, the Chinese said, it's art and you can't go. He said, forget it, he'll go. You know, I'm glad that he went and he travelled around.
You said in your passages about Kashmir, which are fascinating, you said, what did you mean by Sheikh Abdullah putting his family's interests above Kashmiris? What did he do?
One of the costs of the Indira Gandhi, one of the costs of the Congress becoming a family firm, is that all other parties also become the family. And the Congress is the mother of the Indian freedom movement. It's the greatest, the most charismatic and the oldest Indian party. And when Sheikh Abdullah in Kashmir, Bal Thackeray in Maharashtra, Prakash Singh Badal in Punjab, Karunanidhi in Tamil Nadu, so if Indira Gandhi can do this in Congress, why shouldn't I convert my party also into my property, right? So that is one of the tragic fallouts of what happened in the Congress, that converting the Congress to a family firm damaged the Congress, damaged governance, and also damaged other political parties. So in a sense, it was a grievous blow to Indian democracy. So I think that's what I really meant.
Two, three passages where you've mentioned how journalism has played along with this, creating this image. And you gave example of Jairam Ramesh's policies and how he's been trying to do things which are beneficial. You also brought up the dam movement and the solutions with Joy and
Paranjape.
Yeah. In all that, you said that the media has played an almost destructive role in playing the role of supporting the corporate point of view,
the capitalist point of view. Yeah.
Yes.
Apart from the timidity in attacking the corporate sector for its excesses, you know, there's no timidity in exposing government corruption, but there's timidity in exposing collusion by corporate sector. Apart from that also, what's happened, Madhu, compared at least to the 1980s, late 70s, 80s, is the decline of just on-ground reportage. You know, one of the great unacknowledged success stories of this government is the fact that India is now polio-free. And it's partly because of good work by government health services, support by the WHO, funding by the Gates Foundation. You know, but this is a non-controversial story. It should not offend corporate people, but it's not written about. On-ground reportage is something that is discounted in our newspapers. You know, it's all editorial, and even our TV channels even more. And
it's become worse.
This is what is worrying. I mean, apart from blatantly taking a corporate site or seeming to be spokesperson for the CIA, that's one thing. But also just real the texture of social life in India. I mean, India is such a complex, diverse, fascinating place. The interesting things going on all the time, and there's not enough people being sent. The editors are not sending enough reporters in the field to write from the field up. You know, and some people are doing it. One of my favorite newspapers, even though I have no business interest, is Mint. Because Mint sometimes has longer reports, a three-part report on Indian agriculture, talking to farmers in Andhra and Maharashtra. You know, that's the kind of thing reporters should be doing. And that is what, maybe, you know, new media will take care of that. Maybe, you know, the internet is now the way forward. Maybe the internet has more freedom. I don't know. I mean,
You mentioned that the press has no compunctions in exposing corruption, government corruption. Yeah. But have you noticed that nobody had the nerve to expose the family's corruption until Arvind Kejriwal? That story was sitting on everyone's.
That's because of this whole honor among thieves, you know, that as Digvijay Singh said, ki a family ka mamla hai. We won't speak about Ranjan Bhattacharya, so they won't speak about.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you, Madhu.
This is the book, it's Patriots and Partisans. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Madhu.